the reason why privacy is important is not actually because of what companies do with the data. It turns out nobody really cares about that. What's really the problem today are hackers. Hackers are stealing enormous amounts of data. Back in 2004, there was only about 100 million records stolen. This year, last year, there was over 10 billion. I think we're already at 12 billion or 14 billion for this year alone. This is crazy. The pace at which data is getting stolen by hackers is increasing exponentially. But why? Why do hackers care so much? Well, it turns out that the business model today of hackers is either blackmail, so they're sending you a message saying, hey, I've got your pictures, send me a Bitcoin, or I'm going to tell all of your friends about it, or identity theft. Both of those things don't convert 100% of the time. So for every individual that you're hacking, there is a probability of, let's say, 1% that that person will pay up. So really, this is a numbers game. The more data you can hack, the more money you're making by just mass blackmailing people or mass stealing people's identities. In other words, the hacker's ROI is directly correlated to the amount of user data. And because it's very complicated to hack into 1 million people's devices, they're going after companies who are holding data for 1 million people. By centralizing data about a lot of users, companies become prime target for hackers all around the planet. It's a very simple equation. If you invest $1 million into hacking a company, but that company has data on 100 million people, that's a good deal, and probably much less expensive than hacking to 100 million people's phones. And when you ask people, it turns out that only 20% care about what companies do. I don't care about what Facebook does with my data because I trust them that if they do misuse it, they're gonna get slapped by some regulation somewhere. The GDPR in Europe, or you know, the California Privacy Act is coming up soon. Regulation is how you prevent companies from misusing data. But preventing data theft? There is no regulation against that. Hackers don't care by definition. And so this is what people are really scared about. 80% of consumers are scared about their data being stolen, whereas only 20% are scared about companies misusing them. We are not fighting against companies. We're fighting against people hacking those companies. And the best way to protect against that is to provide the tools for those companies not to get hacked in the first place. So privacy by design is something people have been talking a lot about. It's something I've been personally advocating for over 10 years. And I remember in the early days, privacy by design was a very geeky term, right? A few lawyers there were talking about it, and a few privacy and cryptography nerds were talking about it. And like the meetups were maybe like 10 people, right? I think today it's a little bit more important. I mean, judging from how many people are here, I think it's pretty significant. So the best solution to prevent data leaks is simply not to have any data in the first place. The moment you centralize data into one single company, that company will get hacked. There is no such thing as perfect security. You can invest billions of dollars into an infrastructure and a security team, you will eventually get hacked. That's the reality of IT systems. So the only way to guarantee privacy by design is not to hold any data. And this is something that increasingly can be done through something we call edge computing. Rather than sending all the data in one place in the cloud and processing this on one server, why not directly process it where the data is created, on the device of the user? You know, Apple had this huge ad at CES, remember, where they said, what's on your iPhone stays on your iPhone? That's basically them saying, we don't do things in the cloud, we do things on the edge. And edge computing is interesting, not just because of privacy, but also because it gives you much better latency. You're not losing the network time. It gives you offline capabilities. And importantly, it gives you control over your user's experience. Think about what's happening today with China and the US. Who thought that Google and all the other American companies would just stop doing business with Chinese companies? That's crazy. But that's exactly the kind of problem you're facing today. The truth is, if you're dependent on someone else's servers, they can just cut access to the servers and you're dead. That's a fact. At least if it's running on device, it can keep running. So what we built at Snips isn't a consumer product. So actually, we're technically not trying to destroy Alexa. We're trying to provide a technology for anybody to build their own voice assistants. So when you go to our website, you can use our console. You can basically develop and create a completely custom voice assistant, put it in your product, use it yourself at home. And we now have close to 30,000 developers actually building on top of it. So we're one of their largest community in voice. And the number one reason why developers use our technology is because it works. And the number two reason is because of privacy. Privacy is something that nobody thought was important up until recently. And it turns out it's also not a problem for getting performances. We compared the performances of our assistant to those that you typically have in the cloud that I shall not name because I one time got into trouble for doing that. But effectively, you have no decrease in performance. Interestingly, you actually have an increase in performance. It turns out that doing things locally on the user's device enables you to have even better performances than doing things centrally in the cloud. So that's a bit strange, right? And you can do this very fast. All it takes to replicate what Alexa is doing, for example, is one single CPU of a Raspberry Pi. You know, a Raspberry Pi is a $10 kid's computer, right? Do you own one? Yeah, it's a very cheap, super entry-level computer. That's all you need to do the most complicated deep learning, natural language understanding, voice assistant that you can imagine doing today. And you can do this on a few megabytes of RAM. So it's not even that you need a lot of computing power, because people often tell you, you need the cloud, you have no choice, we need computing power. That is a lie. That is a justification for you to send your data. It is technically not correct. So let's imagine now for a second that, and I want to explain how we can achieve that, because to be honest, this is not easy. We're the first team to be able to achieve this. Traditionally, voice assistant, you take the sound coming in from the microphone on one end, and on the other end, you're supposed to say what you understood. So the bigger problem is that the more complicated the use case, the more the number of words you're trying to recognize, the more ambiguous it becomes. So let's imagine you've got a user that says dog. For a computer, dog is actually potentially three different things. It can be transcribed into DAG, so these are the phonetic representation, depends on your accent, or it can be dog, or it can be dig. All three of them are potentially the same probability for the computer. So the computer actually doesn't really know what you're talking about. It has no understanding of what your intention is at that point. It's just trying to map sound into words from a dictionary. And so that creates effectively ambiguity. So the way that voice assistants work today, they just pick one of them at random, pretty much. So this is why sometimes you're saying something to your assistant, you're like, you're so stupid. You don't understand I'm talking about this particular artist. It's because in the catalog of every single possible artist you like to listen to, there is so much ambiguity that there is no way for the assistant to understand what you're actually talking about. And so the way that we're solving this, while reducing the complexity of the models, is through something that we call context-aware speech recognition. The idea is extremely simple. When we speak as humans, we actually have something extra we call context, right? Everybody here knows we're talking about artificial intelligence and privacy. Therefore, everything I'm saying, your brain is actually processing within that context, that box of AI and privacy. So even though what I'm saying doesn't sound accurate, you're going to translate it with a much higher probability into something that makes sense for AI or privacy. And this is exactly what we did here. By basically saying, okay, well, the user is talking about something, we know that that particular assistant has something to do with animals. Let's actually see if we can now get better probabilities. The only thing that is an animal here is the first thing, dog. So by giving an extra information that the assistant is supposed to be about animals, you're able to change the likelihood that we're going to pick the right word and therefore that we're going to get the correct answer. It's that simple. You're basically just doing what humans are doing. And when you look at the performances, what you realize is that in order to contextualize your voice assistant, you need a lot of data. And so this is another thing that people claim is important in the cloud is you're doing everything in a central server, you can reuse other people's data, and therefore you can improve things over time. It is correct. This actually shows you that the more data you're using for contextualizing your assistant, the better it gets at understanding you. So how do you solve that problem when you actually have zero data? Well, the solution is something that's called data generation. The idea is that you're going to basically create fake user data. Why would you actually care about real user data if you can have fake users pretend to be users and actually give you the same kind of data? And so this is something that we made available to developers in our community. You can go on the website, type in 5 examples. So these are examples of an assistant I did for tracking food. You see, it's very simple examples, right? 3 pieces of chicken, 300 grams of salmon. Click the button generate, put your credit card, and a few hours later, by crowdsourcing through a network of people around the world, we're going to be able to generate thousands and thousands and thousands of fake user queries. These are things that were completely generated before you launch your product. And look at the linguistic diversity. So not only does this make more sense in terms of privacy, it's also a very, very good way to solve the cold start problem you often have with voice assistant, which is you're launching a product without data and it doesn't work. This actually makes it work. So the reason why I'm talking about all of this is because I'm trying to make everybody understand that fundamentally, people have been lying to us about privacy. They've been telling us we had no choice but to send all of our data into one server somewhere in the cloud. They said we had to do this because we needed computing power or because the data needed to be used to improve the quality of the services we're getting, neither of which is accurate. And so what I want you to think about is when a company tells you they actually need your data, knowing that a small startup of 100 people like ours can do this, what are they really meaning? They either mean that they don't know how to do it, in which case you probably shouldn't trust them with security anyway, or that they're doing something else. Perhaps their business is actually your data. And is this acceptable today? I don't think so. 20 years ago, when companies had very little data, maybe. There was no real impact. Today, there's too much risk for having companies aggregate so much data. And I think this is going to be the difference fundamentally between a future where increasingly we're going to end up being under surveillance, under stress. We're going to get hacked. We're never going to know, are we talking to someone real? Are we talking to someone stealing their data? I'm getting an email. How can I prove identity? Identity verification is a huge, huge, huge issue in the future. You have to understand this. Today, with 1 minute of voice data, we can copy your voice. I can call your kids and tell them to meet me on the corner of the street. I can call your bank. I can call your CFO in your company, ask them to wire something. Spoofing people's identity is becoming increasingly easy. And this is something I think we should really protect against. You know, we should really make sure that this dystopian future, that really, actually, this is from The Fifth Element. You know, the kind of future people have been telling us we're facing is something we don't let happen. Because at the end of the day, what do we want? And it's actually quite fitting given the weather here. Everybody kind of wants to feel like here, right? You want to feel safe. You want technology to work for you. You don't want to be constantly worried about what's going to happen, having to double check, change your password 20 times a day. No, you don't want to do any of that. You just want to like let technology work in the background and worry about things that really matter to you. Thank you.